So I woke up in the morning and I started drafting the lecture. I'm always a last minute human being, just a catastrophe. But I think this is the way I function. And I realized that three of my favorite projects are titled elsewhere. And that came to me as a big surprise. Back something like 7 years ago, a dear friend of mine called Hany Roshet met me in front of Gypsum Gallery. I recall very well when Gypsum Gallery was in Garden City. And he told me, why are you shooting the street? You're not from the street. No matter how close you are, there's still some distance. And this was lesson number two, distance. When I approached the three names elsewhere, there was something really common. This is way more English than Arabic, by the way. We're in Egypt. When I looked at these three projects, I realized that it's all about juggling. It's not being I feel very bad for non-speaking, non-Arabic speaking guests, so it's flipping into English, which is a catastrophe. فاكتشفت انه المشاريع اللي اسمها elsewhere بتعبر جامد جدا عن how I feel. I always feel like I'm juggling. But then again, I came to terms مع فكرة الجوجلينج دي. الجوجلينج ببساطة شديدة هو حبي اني اكون multidisciplinary human being وانه no one can really capture what I'm doing. Because if you really want to convince people, you need to confuse them. So this is basically what I'm doing. I'm confusing people. My design clients don't know what I'm doing. My artist friends don't know what I'm doing. Everyone thinks I'm a designer. My designer friends think I'm an artist. And this level of confusion really inspires me because it puts people off guard and it takes them off guard. في الحالة دي اللخبطة دي بتخلي البني آدم ينزل الجاردز الكتيرة قوي والحسابات الكتيرة قوي اللي بيبقى عاملها والبرسبشن على الآخر. هاني لما اتكلم معايا وقال لي أنت بتصور الشارع ليه؟ أنت مش في الشارع؟ قلت له هاني أنا محافظ على مسافة معينة بس أنا بصور المشروع ده. What I'm shooting قال لي طب show me what you're working on. So I showed him this. This is basically a very, very simple project that I was shooting aimlessly. And I believe that aimless projects are the most valuable projects. Projects that you don't have an aim or ambition to do. You're just doing it because you want to do it, because you saw something, because you're observing something, because you're keeping something to yourself. Keeping something to yourself reflects how precious it is. When you really want to flaunt or show, you're really caring way more about the audience or who's watching and their judgment and perception of what you're doing. So he saw this and he said, man, this is incredible. Why aren't you exhibiting it? And why do I need to exhibit it? I'm happy. I have like 80 photographs and they're just stocked in my drive and I'm good to go. And actually the bigger reward was the conversations I have with my clients. The project is basically shooting short-lived chalk drawings done by workers in construction sites. So I go visit the site and I find a drawing on the wall and I take a picture of it. And then my client wonders, what are you shooting? Why are you shooting this? This is just scribbling. I say, no, this is art. So they say, no, this is not art. How is this art? I say, define art. Is it because it's expensive or because your neighbor bought this? Is it a social status? How do you define art? Is it a commodity? Is it an expression? Is it a feeling? Is it an emotion? Why isn't this art? This carries most of the most valuable definitions of art. It's selfless, it's pure, it's instinctive, it's short-lived, everything changes. So why is this not art? And then the conversation with my clients build up and they start believing that this is art. And to me, this was the bigger reward because this is when clients that did not really perceive art in a specific way started understanding that art can be anything. I kept on shooting this, and this series was called What If Art Is Elsewhere? It was mocking my clients and mocking curators. Sorry, because curators have become gods on the hill, and they dictate how we see art and who is an artist and who isn't, and how much and where and when. They can kill artists or they can glorify artists. not all. All generalizations are false. But the power of the art industry has really overshadowed a lot of the intuitiveness of art. So this was really appealing to me because this, I mean, the art industry has become some sort of closed gate cabal with the magazines and the critics and the museums and the exhibitions with all manifestations and all the cultural aspect to it dictated by government. So, I mean, there's so much politics and dynamics in the art that it has really drifted from the purity and the intuitiveness of an artist just surviving in his studio or her studio and just working without the calculations, without needing a manager, without needing all that. This really gave me hope that people can just express themselves. Someone felt the need to express, so a piece of chalk on the wall. Hadiki for Cite ke bflek.
It's one of my favorite projects.
It's actually a life-changing project for me, and Heba was the one to promote it, and it was exhibited in Paris at the Cité des Arts, and thanks to her I met Bruno Bougelel, who is one of my favorite curators, and when he signed the book he gave me, he said, not a curator. This is a gift from someone who is not a curator. So, I mean, this dialogue is in constant need of approaching because the checks and balances need to always be addressed so that the power is somehow distributed fairly. This project was all about photographs of workers' drawings in construction sites that I visit. It was spontaneous. It was taken with my phone, and the names of the villas were written under the piece. I mean, why is this not Basquiat, for instance? Why is this not Jean-Michel Basquiat? He doesn't know, but he probably would have been Jean-Michel Basquiat, right? This guy killed his superior. This is Thabit, and this is لقد قتل Thabit. All right, so actually there's a narrative, there's emotion, there is something. And this was someone counting the days. And then I realized there's another elsewhere. So the first elsewhere was the drawings existing out of the white cube, out of the gallery space, and seeing the birth of that in a construction site was extremely inspiring to me. And then another revelation came. This is the exhibition actually you will see tonight. As I was walking by Al-Ghuri Mosque specifically, I realized that the carpets are not consistent. They are donated by people living in the area. So someone living in the end of the street donates a carpet. Someone else donates another carpet. These carpets are charged with the energy of their owners. So Ahmed, بس الجادة بتاعتها اللي شافت حب وخناق وعياط ومكرونة وبرابير وكل حاجة في الآخر السجادة دي اتحطت في الجامع and it got somehow purified and then it met عم محمد رب and they became friends and probably they don't know each other and then another one came and then the mosque keeper becomes the curator because he sets them up. The rug comes, so he's a curator without knowing he's a curator and he starts setting up these carpets and then they become this huge collage. And then you go to another exhibition, another mosque, and you find the same behavior happening, another mosque. The idea here was historic mosques, antiquities. Mosques that are 700, 800, 900 years old with non-consistent rugs. To me, it's a very bittersweet project. I love it so much. I think it's very organic, very contemporary, very humane, very generous. It, in a way, defines beauty, which is undefinable, basically as intention. For me, working as a designer, defining beauty is a very, very big challenge. It changes every day. But here I arrived to the conclusion that maybe beauty is intention. Maybe it's just the intention of beautifying in itself is just beauty. If you decide this is how you want to look today and you feel it's beautiful, then it's beautiful. If you paint your wall, I mean, if a kid paints the wall the way they want and they draw, they think it's beautiful. So it's beautiful. It doesn't need an interior designer. It doesn't need a world-class architect to decide that this is beautiful or not. The intention of these rugs make them beautiful. Although historical mosques perhaps deserve more proper rugs, but again, who defines proper? So it's always this contradiction. This is Irafai Mosque, and apparently this is where most people come to pray, so this is where the rugs were placed. And then the exhibition was all about close-ups, taken with my phone, again, selecting my frames carefully to celebrate the beauty. Because here I'm actually celebrating the intention of beauty. It's not a critical project, it's not a documentary project, it's purely documenting the intention of beauty. And then comes a very sensitive elsewhere. And this actually is perhaps the core of this talk, which is anything can open to anything. You just need to be open and sensitive and tolerant and accommodating and observant. Ahmed Helmi, a dear friend of mine who passed away a month ago, he was very courageous, all right? He had this willpower to always experiment and to push boundaries and to have social responsibility and paying for that. There's a price for that. I mean, it's so easy to claim that you stand for social responsibility. It's so easy to claim that you stand for human rights. But I mean, go to jail for human rights? No, sorry, thank you. I'll just deactivate my account. Pay some money for your cause? No, sorry, it's a bit tight these days. This is what happens, right? If you actually stand by your cause and it's painful and you pay for it, that's when it really counts. And that's when it really arrives and reaches hearts. Because everyone can say anything. So Ahmed decided, he owns one of the oldest chair factories in Egypt and the Middle East. And he decided, Karim, Nihel, I want to do a project with you guys, experimental. So basically he goes to the biggest design fair, pays the biggest rent for the booth, and then he has no clue what we're doing. No clue. And he's not there to sell chairs. So the challenge here for us was to work around social responsibility, about awareness, about inclusivity. The whole idea there that we came up together was to shoot chairs that were designed elsewhere. The message Meuble Sharq had was inclusivity. Our factory's doors are open. Please come in. Give us designs. We will promote and accommodate. We will support young designers. We will support young talents. The year before, he actually had a whole exhibition about autistic children, where he opened the factory for them to come in and do their designs and see them see reality. The way their parents perceived them after how the kids were productive and how they were so proud to have produced and designed chairs was priceless. So this put a very big challenge on us going for round two. What we decided to do, I was always fascinated by how security guards and porters reuse and have this design intervention on chairs. So it's a broken chair, a piece of metal comes in and a piece of upholstery comes in and a rope ties it like this and then it becomes a chair. Why is it not a design chair? So if a porter or a security guy with the least tools and materials is capable of designing a chair, and the biggest factory is willing to promote these chairs, I think what better of a message would be sent out for everyone to come in and knock on the door and provide designs. And so it was a very strong message of inclusivity. If porters can design chairs, if we're willing to celebrate their chairs, if we're willing to exhibit their chairs, and the exhibition again was called Design Elsewhere. Apparently, I constantly want to be elsewhere. I don't know. But maybe the elsewhere is right here. Who defines what's here and what's elsewhere?
Elsewhere is
here. No, elsewhere is here. All the time. I'll actually tell you, and it's a saying that will end this chapter of the lecture, which defines that. So basically... So basically what we did was a block, a solid wall, with nothing that you can see. You go in, there's a cinema room displaying a video on curtains, and six porters' chairs exhibited. People were completely shook by the idea of how is a chair factory exhibiting six chairs done by porters. But the question in itself raised the idea, because a good question is half the answer. This is what was displayed in front of every chair.
بدأت بقى أعمل بالرجل كده جبته وقلبته ومسكته يقدر يقاوم معايا أو يواجه الموقف
كرسي نفسه وبعد كده جبتله العزان ده مشترك اخترت شباك فرشت فوقه ورحت ربطته بسلك جبتله الاثنين القاعده دي السفنج برضه ورحت ربطتها
شوف كل اللي حواليك بشكل مختلف احيي الفضول اللي جواك وتعالى خبط الباب باب المصنع مفتوح ومستني اي فكره حلوه نحب نعملها مع بعض مش مهم انت مين راجل ولا ست ولد ولا بنت كبير ولا صغير محترف ولا هاوي المهم ان عينك وروحك وعقلك يجي بفكره جديده من مصنع الكراسي من مبرشات من كل الصناعه احنا ممكن نعمل ايه مع بعض مستنيين
challenge to actually describe inclusivity in that specific sense. The elsewhere is always inspiring, and this came across my path a year ago, and I thought it was very telling. I would ask you to read it, please. I leave this place to go to another place just to validate my existence. And once I return, I know that my existence is only temporary. I leave again and I return. So we are in this constant and perpetual state of being and not being, and then being and not being. And then when you're away, you get to see things. The whole trick here is to juggle, is to know how to cross the line and come back, because there's a slight chance of dancing with the devil. It's very, very, it's a very slim line of having to taste something just to understand it and not get addicted to it or not get influenced to it, by it, and so on. So being a designer allows me that, allows me to tap on territories that I have privilege. And I think privilege needs to be looked and addressed in the eye. يعني أنا وعلي كنا بنتكلم عن privilege في الحياة. الwhite privilege. الwhite privilege is fantastic. I mean, someone comes to Egypt to work on, on an essay or a photo document or something, the amount of privileges just open up. So, I mean, if you look things into the eye and name them as they are, life changes. It saves a lot of time, it saves a lot of barriers, it saves a lot of masks. I believe in that fully. So me being a designer, yeah, the bourgeois, yeah, it's not an offense. You need to be aligned with what you do. That's when you see things properly. So me going to construction sites gave me a lot of privilege. I do not need to shoot the street constantly, whereas my subject matter exists behind gated communities. The real privilege I have is crossing the line and being unnoticed. I am part of the circle. I'm not an intruder. And I do not have the intruder eye. Part two of this talk, it's divided into three parts, and if you're lucky, it's going to be four, but you're going to have to pay. I believe knowing oneself is extremely important. This is a very famous saying on the Temple of Apollo, which has a pun. بتحمل معنيين. معنى know thyself, the constant state of knowing oneself. And knowing yourself. Basically, you're just that tiny, given the new universe that we've just discovered. And knowing one's distance. Whether we are that close or that close, we just need to identify both. So this project was one of these, slightly IA. This project was extremely interesting and close to my heart. Deal Butte, in the high-end developments. These are houses in the high-end developments, and they settle. So such expensive houses with such facility and such know-how and such client base, and they settle. Settle means it just settles, basically. The soil is not supporting the building, so the building cracks. And then the building cracks, whether it's before or after the owner lives in it. If they live in it, they give them a new house. It's fine. It's all right. If they're not living, they compensate and they fix it. So to me, this was mind-blowing. How in a high-end development cannot a simple two-story villa be built? ايه الصعوبة في ان احنا نبني فيلا بكل الامكانيات استشاريين موجودين مواد انشائية موجودة كلاينت موجود فلوس موجودة فين المشكلة؟ المشكلة في كراك كبير قوي موجود في المجتمع. The building here in my project depicted the human being. The human being is way more important than a building. The human being here, or the building here, sorry, is a breathing organism. We have a crack. We have a social, political, ideological crack. And it's part of how systems and regimes manage all over the world. I mean, divide and conquer, it's so easy. It's so cliche also. But we fall in it every time. It's okay. So basically here, this project was me documenting the cracks in high-end villas. Without anyone bugging me or annoying me, because I'm allowed to be there. So if I see a crack, I take a picture. I see another crack, I take a picture. And then what I did was stitch them all together in one big, huge piece called Watahya. Watahya means and live. All right? So basically, and live on a huge crack that unites us all. I collaborated with Maryam Farid. Maryam is a dear friend, brilliant artist who uses stitches, using metal stitches, and she usually mends my work. الشغل ده كله متخيط بخيط metal, actually. وفي الخلطة بتاعت المجتمع كله، مش بس الـ high-end developments، لأن الكراك ده مش سايب حاجة. الكراك ده موجود في الـ high-end developments، موجود في المباني الأثرية، موجود في العشوائية، بس هو حقه يبقى موجود في العشوائية لقلة الإمكانيات، مش حقه يبقى موجود في الـ high-end development، مش حقه يبقى موجود في المباني الاثريه كمان. فهنا بيسكلي اللي اتعمل ان انا خدت كل الكراكس اللي شفتها وجمعتهم في عمل واحد كان حوالي 3 متر في متر ونص. And this was the outcome. What's really funny, it was sold to a hotel, and it was sold in a lobby of a hotel. It's a completely socio-political project that really slams the whole idea, and then it was hanging in a moving pic somewhere. It was so interesting, I just loved it. So what I'm trying to show here are two things, basically. Here I'm knowing myself, here I'm reflecting who I am. I'm an architect by profession. This is what I do. I observe cracks. I know what cracks come from. I know how buildings settle. But then again, there's another part of me, which is an observer. I observe my surrounding. I observe the social circle. I observe the socio-political scene. It's our role in life to observe. Another know thyself, know thy distance was retrogression. This was exhibited at the Biennale, the Dakar Biennale. The flip side of this coin are the lawful owners of historical houses, who live in historical houses in old Cairo. These houses are very sensitive, but they are the owners. They are 99 years old, the houses, 98 years old. The houses are very difficult to upkeep. They're very difficult to maintain. And if their child is not feeling well, they're gonna have to remove a piece and sell it, and then, but they have to. What can they do? Right? It's survival. So what I did was create a handmade filter made of sensitive glass, vintage and salvaged glass, and I used it to shoot the owners of these houses behind that layer. So what I'm consistently doing is observing the built environment and what its constituents are, مكونات built environment اللي حوالينا, and observe the human element in it, and then juggle me being a photographer, visual artist, and me being an architect on the other hand, and sticking my tongue in a playful way, hopefully, without going to jail. And this is what happens. This is what happens when you know that one thing will lead to many. Once I have opened my eyes through the project of the chalk drawings on the walls, I realize there's a whole world in the gated community that I need to observe. My fascination with the street is reflected. He's late. And he has a work that should be hung on the wall for the 8 p.m. exhibition. That's it in his hand. الإحساس الجوجلينج الممتع ده إن أنا بروح شغلي ها الساعة 10-11 الصبح بشتغل بس في نص راس تانية بتلعب بيسكلي بدور على حاجة تانية observation بما إني هناك سموه بقى كسل سموه مالتي تاسكينج سموه استسهال سموه مش قادر أنزل الشارع سموه ما عنديش وقت سموه زي ما تسموه بس أنا جوه البتاع ده قاعد طب ما انا شايف الحاجه طب يطلع حاجه يعني مش رايح حته تانية يعني رايح اجيب الخضار فلقيت بتاع الحاجه الساقعه في السكه طب ما اجيبهاش ليه عادي فالكلاينتس ابتدت تنزعج يعني انا قريب قوي I'll run out of business بس it's fine it's perfectly fine يعني once I get caught and I'm really putting a lot of effort to get caught يعني I'm pushing it تعرفة يعني intensely انه I'm shooting your feet why are you shooting our feet this is a meeting I'm shooting the drawings on the wall. Why are you shooting the drawings on the wall? This is a meeting. Have you stopped being a designer and now you're a photographer? And then this question really, really pisses me off. And then we have drifted. To be very honest, we're back to being polymaths and multidisciplinary human beings. I think previously, in the past 20 years, this was taken away, but now it's coming back. And I think contemporary art is really pushing the boundary on that because artists have become so malleable and so diverse that you can actually work with multiple mediums, create multiple topics, and move forward with many things. Hi, I'm sorry, I'm late. -5. I'm not sure. So, the idea that the client tells me, "هو أنت بقيت مصور ولا أنت مهندس؟" هو إيه المشكلة؟ فين المشكلة؟ هو لعلمك ممكن لو أنا مصور أفيدك أكتر وأنا مهندس يعني أساعد يعني لو عندي artistic intent هيبقى مفيد في الشغل. جدتي شخصيا ست مثقفه كده قاريه وكلمتني من 15 سنه او 14 سنه قالت لي كريم حبيبي هو انت بطلت تبقى مهندس؟ قلت لها ليه هو مين ايه اللي حصل؟ قالت لي بس بيقولوا انت بقيت مصور. قلت لها اه هصور شويه وهستلبط وهعمل تريكو يعني هعمل اي حاجه يعني. فقالت لي انت ما بطلتش تبقى مهندس؟ قلت لها لا ما بطلتش. قالت لي طب خلاص صور براحتك. فقصدي المايند سيت دي كارثيه بس اعتقد اتغيرت. I think it's changing drastically to the better. Anyways, when I juggle between, I realized actually this lecture or this talk made me somehow arrange my thoughts that I have been constantly visiting two different trends. بتحرك بين منطقتين دائما. يعني فعلا النهارده اكتشفت ده والله العظيم الساعه 7 الصبح وانا قاعد بوضب التوك بتاعت النهارده دي. الواحد بيضطر يذاكر قبل الامتحان فبيزنق نفسه فبيكتب كلمتين فبيبقى ليهم لازم. اكتشفت كلنا صح؟ كلنا بيعمل غير كده بيضحك على نفسه يعني. وبرشام بقى بس ما بقاش كله ديجيتال دلوقتي ولا ايه؟ ابقى عادي لسه؟ فاكتشفت ان انا I move between two realms. The realm of alternative solutions اللي انا انبهرت بيه جدا اول ما ابتديت التصوير بالتوك توك تحديدا. التوك توك ده شيء عظيم جدا 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 شيء مذهل في حلاوته وجماله ونجاحه وكل حاجه في الدنيا. هو حل بديل. هو الشوارع ضيقه والناس محتاجه تتحرك. التعالي بقى اللي بيظهر من مجموعه من الناس يعتقد ان هم يمتلكوا او يملكوا الحل شيء مزعج 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 لاقصى درجاته. الناس ما لقتش حل. الست والحاجة عايزة تتحرك من آخر الشارع لأوله معاها حاجة في إيدها تقيلة هتعمل إيه؟ العيل عايز يروح المدرسة فلازم يركب التوك توك من حطة الأتوبيس. فأي واز فاسينيتد باي ذيس سولوشن ده حل. فنزلت أفهم إيه قصة التوك توك جاية منين. فرحت قعدت في بولاق حوالي أسبوعين عشت مع التوك توك. التوك توك ليه حياة كاملة مكتملة وليه نظام نفس النظام اللي ما في اي حاجه في الدنيا. Am I too Arabic now?
Yes,
you perfect for a time. Yeah, you got the first half of the lecture. The second is quite similar anyways, yeah, nothing new. Yeah, it's visual. Yeah, you can count the letters. One, two, three. So the idea of alternative solutions. احنا شعب قائم على حلول بديله، مش عايزين نعتمد على الحكومه خالص، مش عايزين، مش بنثق. عايز اتعالج مش هتعالج عند الحكومه، عايز تتعلم مش هتعلم عند الحكومه، عايز مواصلات مش هينفع تستنى الحكومه. الميكروباص ظهر غصبا رغما عن انف الحكومه، التوك توك ظهر رغما عن انف الحكومه، العشوائيات ظهرت رغما عن انف الحكومه، المهرجانات ظهرت رغما عن انف الحكومه، هتفضل الحاجات تخرج رغما عن انف هو ايفر يعتقد انه هيسيطر، مش هيحصل. So we, انا بتكلم عادي. هو في سجن في الجونه؟ ما اعرفش ان في سجن هنا. لو هتسجن هتسجن في الجونه صح؟ انا هنا اراضي محايده ولا ايه؟ انا عادي على صح؟ سوفرنتي مختلفه خالص صح؟ صح؟ اه انا شايف كده يعني. وممكن تحس البتاع ده مش وحش يعني كبير كده وملحلح طراوه وعلى البحر وايه كمان. ففكره التعالي دي اللي لا لا التوك توك ده وحش التوك توك ده مزعج المهرجانات دي مزعجه البتاع العشوائيات لا لا شيلوا العشوائيات تلاقي كده حلول كده سامجه جدا ها شيلوا البتاع شيل ايه يا معلم ده 99.9% من الكون. حتى لما للاسف الموضوع بيبقى صادم جدا لما الواحد يجي يتكلم على النمط السائد في المعمار المصري مع حد من قرايبي بدون ذكر مين عشان ما دي بقى لا دي الحكومه بجد يعني دي اللي خاف منها بجد يعني ف لا الاركتكتشر بتاعت مصر هي وسط البلد لا مش وسط البلد انا اسف اللي اتبنى وقت الخديوي اسماعيل وقت الخديوي توفيق مش وسط مش مصر ولا بالم هيلز مصر. I'm sorry هو مصر هي المرج والخصوص وكل العشوائيات اللي الناس اضطرت تبني بيوتها عشان تعيش فيها. هو ده على فكره حق انت لو في اي حته في العالم في الصحراء محتاج تعيش فبنيت اربع حيطان طوب وعشت جواهم ده حقك. The right for residence, for shelter. It's so simple. People have created their own solutions. Music, transport, health, education. You don't give me a solution, I find my solution. It's the survival kit. It's so simple, it's so basic. So this was one of the realms that consumed me for a very long time. It started with the tuk-tuk. This was 2015. It was exhibited at the off-Biennale at Dhabi 1718. It was a very simple project. I was quite lucky to deal with or to be mentored by a very inspiring curator, Simon Jamy, who worked with me on this project. It was a very important learning curve for me. I was very excited about taking portraiture, and then he told me, your hero is not the portrait, your hero is the vehicle. So put the portrait aside. And then when I studied for 2 weeks, 3 weeks, immersed in the whole process, there's a whole universe there. Scheduling, the maintenance, the know-how. It's just so beautiful. Anyways, one of the other alternative solutions is the project that you will see tonight, which is between here and elsewhere. It's an alternative. People did not find drugs to pray on in the mosques, so they basically provided their own. Last but not least, we still have some time, that's good. Back to the built environment. So like I was saying, I move flexibly between alternative solutions and the built environment. Alternative solutions because it's something that touches us all, despite the fact that we don't think of it that way. If the tuk-tuk stops, our lives will stop. The whole country will be on stop. So the alternative solutions are part of the bigger picture. The more introspective aspect are projects that happen inside the compounds, inside where I work. And this specifically is very, very close to my heart. And I've been doing it aimlessly for the past maybe 2 years with no aim. I don't want to exhibit it. I don't know what to do with it. It's not even aesthetically appealing. It's just there. It's an observation that I just captured, that I'm keeping. And it's the placement of mattresses that the workers choose to call home. So basically, when it's winter, the worker or the guard of a multi-million Egyptian pound property selects the bathroom to sleep in. And that's the master's room. He's the master. He owns the house for a year, year and a half, depending on how fast we finish the project. And basically his choice of locating the mattress is just spectacular. When the weather is good, it's on the view. When the weather is cold, it's inside the bathroom, it's under the staircase. So is a home the size of it, the luxury of it, the details? Is it the flaunt of your capability? Or is it warmth? Is it personal? Is it hugging? Is it embracing? What defines a home? This is my new question. This is my new pursuit. To try to understand what calls home and what defines it. So these are all specifically placed mattresses. This one is viewing the pyramids. So basically he placed it, and I truly have no idea what I'm doing with this. It could be collage. The end of it could be this lecture. I don't know. It's just out there. It's an observation that existed. Maybe it could be an article. Maybe it can be a film. But again, things start with observation. This guy likes high beds. And then another observation is that during site visits, we stand in a circle. And this circle accommodates everyone. It's the social circle. It's everyone. It's us, my team, the client, the contractor, the worker. And what I do is just take a very simple shot with my phone during the meeting. Again, I'm really trying to piss my clients off, truly, in any possible way. I'm in a meeting and just take wide angle and just go, psht. What are you doing? Shooting your shoes. I like them. You'll know later. So basically, this is the only moment where everyone unites, where different social circles unite. After the project is done, the worker is gonna leave. No one's gonna remember him, her name, his name. The contractor, probably they're gonna hate his guts. They're never gonna know or want to know their name again. Maybe, maybe not, we'll be friends. No one knows. But then again, this moment in time where the whole circuit of different social levels communicate. And they're not aesthetic. These are not photos for Instagram, nor photos for an exhibition. It's just an inspiration that I will keep taking till I find what to do with, or nothing. This is what I'm trying to say, إنه مش بالضرورة إن الواحد يكون بيعمل حاجة وحاطط عينه على هدف قوي إنه هعمل معرض بعد سنة لازم أعمل معرض وحطيتها على انستغرام وخدتش لايكس. لو الموضوع مش معمول عشان الواحد عايز يعمله مش هينجح. هيقف عند نقطة هيخبط السقف كده وهيبقى طموحكم واقف في حتة الآخر هو المتحكم فيها. إنما لو أنتم مبسوطين وأنتم بتعملوا اللي بتعملوه فعلى الأقل أنتم مبسوطين. يعني في حد اتبسط. لو حد زاد عليه بقى خير وبركة، بس على الأقل ابتدينا بحد اللي هو أصحاب الشغل نفسه. مش هطول عليكم عشان لو في أسئلة. These are four very easy tips if you want to pursue some sort of body of work. مش بالضرورة مشروع فوتوغرافي، مش بالضرورة فيلم قصير، مش بالضرورة installation, whatever it is. You have to know what you stand for. مشكلة كبيرة قوي إنه بنتزق كده يمين وشمال، محدش يتمسك بقضية معينة مقتنع بيها كتير. Which medium to use? And this really taps on بجد explore all mediums possible. Everything is open. Everything. Everything is accessible. Everything is on your phones. Mm-hmm. يعني to hell with perfection. To hell with it. It's the biggest misconception on earth. Better done than perfect. Basically. How many projects fail to exist because perfection stands in the way? Well, like that. Just have fun. Hang the work the way it hangs. Shoot with your phone. Print it on shitty paper. Do anything. Just do it. Seriously, I mean, again, this is such a dogma that we are trapped in, that we need to do this, that we need to hang on that, it's just bullshit. Who is your audience? Not that you need to please them, but so that you don't get this wrong. Who is your audience means how will you present your work? What's the best way to reach them? If you want to reach to anyone. And then, last but not least, relearn astonishment. We need to constantly be astonished. It's so easy. Kids are constantly astonished. We just fail and lose this trait as we go older and more comfortable with things around us. Everything is astonishing. This is astonishing. This mic is astonishing. This thing is astonishing. Everything is astonishing. Just look at it in a different way. Observe it. I mean, the layers that you've created through your life, through the people that you've met, through the places that you went to, will definitely add an extra layer to anything you see or observe. Thank you very much.
Karim, our guest. Karim, we want to thank you. Thank you for always being with Photopia. Thank you. I'm all right, Karim. Big hug, group hug, group hug. Yeah, you can stage, yeah. Thank you so much.